My dear students, welcome to EPG Patashala program. I am Professor Thyagarajan, the head of the Department of Sanskrit, Presidency College, Chennai, who is going to discuss about the prose and champu kavyas in Sanskrit, which forms the part of the paper Aesthetics and Fine Arts. We have already seen in other modules regarding the kavyas, which are classified as Shravya kavyas and Drishya kavyas. Shravya kavyas are the literary works that are read or heard. Drishya kavyas are the kavyas that are depicted. They are none other than dramas. Today, we are going to see a further classification in the Shravya kavyas. They are Padya Kavya, Gadya Kavya, and Champu Kavyas. Padya Kavyas are the compositions made by the poets with meters. So it is only a metrical presentation in the form of verses. Prose is in the form of sentences, and Champu Kavya, which we are going to deal with it later in this module, has prose and poetry mixed together. Now we are going to see what is prose and who are all the prose writers in Sanskrit literature. Prose writers are so meager in Sanskrit literature when compared to poetry writers. They are only handful, and we can say that only a few have gained the popularity too. Bana, Harsha, and other writers have contributed to prose section of literature. In this module, we will find out what are the prose kavyas, and in that also, what are the historical kavyas. And then we will see what are Champu Kavyas. As regards prose writers, we will discuss about Bana, Subandhu, and other writers. And in Champu Kavyas also, we will find out very, very important authors. Prose works are called Gadya Kavyas in Sanskrit, as I told you already. They come under Shravya Kavya. Dandin defines a prose as that Kavya which is free from metrical lines. In the Vedic literature, several Brahmanas and Upanishads are written in prose. In Puranic literature also, there are some narrations that are carried on in prose. But during the later ages, prose work was used only as a medium of commentary on works of philosophy and grammar. Patanjali's Mahabhashya and the grammatical sutras of Panini, and Shankara, Ramanuja, and Madhva's commentary on Brahma Sutras of Vyasa are all in prose. The Mahabhashya of Patanjali, in particular, is considered the best specimen of prose during the earlier period. In the beginning of the classical period, there was a paucity of prose works. Verses or Padya Kavyas were found easy to remember, and prose was not. Therefore, prose was not recognized to be the vehicle for the thoughts of the poets. Moreover, extraordinary talents needed to compose prose as preponderance of compounds with epithets piled upon one another has been spoken as the very life of prose. Little narration and more of description are considered as the characteristics of prose. It was therefore more hard for a poet to compose prose than verse. See, there is a saying, Gadyam Kavinam Nikasham Vadanti. What does it mean? That a prose is a touchstone for the poets. That means it will test their ability, test their imagination, test their way of presentation, etc. Gadyam Kavinam Nikasham Vadanti. It was easy for those writers to compose in poetry, but most of the poets have miserably failed to compose prose. Why? Even Kalidasa has not attempted to compose any prose work. It may be due to the fact that they were having easy way of rendering their wit and wisdom through poetry than prose. But some writers like Banabatta have excelled in composing prose, and they stand as the example for composing prose in Sanskrit. Patanjali in his Mahabhashya mentions three prose works: Vasavadatta, Sumanottara, and Bhaimarati, without mentioning the author's name. Bana in his Arshacharita praises the Akhyayika and mentions one Bhattara Harichandra without mentioning his prose. It is clear that the prose was already in use, but the earliest prose written purely with literary purpose, now available to us, belongs to 6th and 7th century AD only. Now let us see how the prose work has emanated. The composition, the art of composing prose has emanated. According to earlier scholars like Bamaha, prose works are divided into two classes called Katha and Akhyayika. In Akhyayika, according to Bamaha, subject matter is the actual experience of the writer. The narrator being the hero himself, the story is told in pleasing style, divided into chapters called Uchvasas and containing verses in Vaktra or Aparavaktra meters. The story must indicate a future happening. Scope may be allowed to poetic invention, and the theme may also embrace subjects like abduction of a maiden, fighting, separation, and the final triumph of the hero. This must be completely in Sanskrit. So, there are two divisions, Katha and Akhyayika, we have seen, and the grammar of it. Now, in Katha, the subject is generally an invented story. So, one has to invent some story, and then he has to narrate it in the form of prose. It should not be a hero, as in the case of Akhyayika. There is no divisions called Uchvasas, or no Vaktra or Aparavaktra meter. Slokas may be composed in Arya meters. The language may be either Sanskrit or Apabhramsha also. Dandin, the author of Kavyadarsha, criticizes these divisions of prose into Katha and Akhyayika and considers these requirements not as essential, but more or less formal. The prose works of Bana, Dandin and Subandhu are considered to be the most important prose works in Sanskrit, regarding which we are going to see one by one. Dandin, the great grandson of Bharavi, regarding whom we have already seen in another module, that as person who has written the work Kiratarjuniyam and who has also gained the title as Chatra Bharavi, who is noted for his Artha Gaurava. So he is such a person to whom is born as the grandson. So Bharavi is also a scholar, and the Dandin, who hails from his family, is from the scholarly family. Dasakumara Charita, as the title itself suggests, deals with the adventure of an young man of whom 3 were princes and 7 were the sons of ministers. This prose, as it is available to us now, consists of 3 parts: Purvapitika, Dasakumara Charita proper, and Uttarapitika. The Purvapitika in 5 Uchvasas deals with the birth of the 10 boys and their coming under the care and protection of King Rajahamsa and the adventures of 2 young men. The proper Dasakumara Charita deals with the story of 8 other young men. The Uttarapitika, a short chapter, contains the story of the lost young man left unfinished in the Dasakumara Charita proper. Dandin is undoubtedly and unquestionably a master in his use of language. He is already acclaimed as a person who could render beautiful sentences. That's why he was given the accolade or the praise in the form of Dandinaha Padalalityam. So it is as if Dandin alone could handle Lalita Padas. He is perfectly capable of using simple and easy narrations. He is beyond doubt a master of prose style, and it is a pity that his model was not taken by the later writers who chose the complicated style of Bana and Subandhu. This Dandin is assigned to later half of 6th century AD. Now we come to Subandhu, who wrote Vasavadatta, the work. This work is totally different from the Swapna Vasavadatta of Bhasa. That's a drama, whereas this is a prose. Subandhu has been praised by Bana of 7th century AD in his Harshacharita, he is generally assigned to first half of 7th century AD. His prose romance Vasavadatta describes the story of Udayana legend, made famous by number of Sanskrit poets. So in Sanskrit dramatic literature, Udayana legend is very popular. Of course, this Udayana legend emerged out of the legends narrated by Gunadya in his Brihatkatha, and different versions of Brihatkatha stories have been brought out by Chaimendra and others. The general theme of this Harshacharita appears to be falling in love of passionate hero with a heroine and their final reunion after a series of romantic adventures in which dream vision, taking parrots, magic steed, voice from the heaven are all introduced. Though his descriptive power is appreciated by all his constant search for poetic concepts, puns, and apparent incongruity makes his work more tiresome. Here I want to say that Subandhu, noted for his puns, claims that Pratyachara Sleshamayam Kavyam Idam, he says. He has made pun in each and every letter. Perhaps his claim is held high by him, but the hair splitting puns used by him had not reached the readers. That is perhaps one among the reasons that this particular work, Vasavadatta and the author Subandhu, have not gained popularity as Banabatta. Now we will think about Banabatta. He is the author of two kavyas. One happens to be historical kavya, that is Harshacharita. The other one, by name Kadambari, is a prose romance. In his prose Harshacharita, Bana gives an account of himself and his family. He was patronized by the general great king Sriharsha of 7th century AD. He wrote his great prose romance Kadambari. He has also written a historical prose Harshacharita. In literary merit, Kadambari is supreme. There is a statement appreciating this work, Kadambari. Kadambari rasajnanam aharopi narochate. If a person is interested in Kadambari, he won't be interested in taking food, because Kadambari means liquor, as well as honey also. In some places they have used it as honey also. Whatever may be the case, if liquor or honey makes one forgets himself, so does the romance Kadambari. Not only that, he is claimed as a great writer who covers all the subjects, just like Mahabharata, wherein you find discussed all the subjects. Banabatta also discusses. That's why Banabatta's style is praised as Bano Chishtam Jagat Sarvam. So the entire world has been completely described by him, and there is nothing remaining out of the purview of his writing in his prose. This work, Kadambari, is rhythmical. His long compounds are clearly built. All the native critics praise his Gadya Kavya, while he is criticized by the Westerners for his style, because according to the Westerners, Banabatta always resorts to repetitions. He says the same thing with the different synonyms. But it is not so. Just for the sake of rhythm, he is combining long sentences. And at the same time, when he is giving the synonyms, you must know that he is, first of all, profound with vocabulary, and he wants his readers to understand the synonyms that he uses appropriately in the descriptions. So his Gadya Kavya, though criticized, has to be appreciated. But unfortunately, it is said that Banabatta could not complete his Kadambari fully and died. And it was taken up by his son Bhushana Bana, who completed the second part. But at the same time, he could not excel his father in the presentation. Moreover, in this work, in the structure of the work is that the first part of the work will be so big, the second part will be so small. Perhaps the reason is that his son Bhushana Bhatta felt that my father took up this work and without finishing it he died. And if I am continuing, I may also die without finishing it. Therefore, he wanted to quicken the process and ended it in a simple way. So, the second part happened to be very small. Now, coming to Harshacharita, the first important of decidedly historical nature is the Harshacharita of Banabhatta belonging to 7th century. Bana begins his narrative in 5 Uchvasas, but it is left unfinished. Bana gives about himself and his family in this work, as I told you already. Now let us see another work, Vikramanka Devacharita. Towards the beginning of 11th century AD, in the court of King Chalukya, Vikramaditya, a poet by name Bilhana, patronized by the king, wrote his historical kavya Vikramanka Devacharita. This poem describes the history of King Vikramaditya in 17 cantos. It begins with an account of some of the predecessors of Chalukya dynasty and then narrates the story of Vikrama. In Vikramanka Devacharita, the historical matter occupies only a minor portion. The poet mingles much of the imaginary with real. The supernatural element plays an important part in the story, and the intervention of Lord Shiva in the affairs of the hero is of frequent occurrence. In spite of all these, Bilhana's Vikramanka Devacharita is considered as one of the most important historical kavyas. He has also written an erotic lyric Chaura Panchashika and a drama by name Karna Sundari. Rajatarangini. This is a work by Kalkana, a great poet. This work is of historical importance. He lived in Kashmir and has recorded that he lived during the reign of Jayasimha of Kashmir between 1127 and 1159 AD. Kalkana wrote his great work Rajatarangini, describing completely the history of from the period of Ashoka till the end of his own time. It is said Kalkana took his source from Nilamata Purana, which is considered early chronicle of Kashmirian history. Even in Rajatarangini, there are some marvelous episodes which are not believable under ordinary circumstances. With all these defects, Rajatarangini remains to this day the most important historical kavyas in Sanskrit literature. In the same 12th century AD, another poet of Kashmir by name Jalkana wrote his historical kavya Somapala Vilasa, describing the history of the king Somapala, who ruled Rajapuri in the neighborhood of Kashmir. Vemu Bhupala Charita is another work. Following the examples of Bana, Vamana Bhatta Bana of 15th century AD wrote his historical kavya Vemu Bhupala Charita of Viparnarayana Charita. He was also called Abhinava Bhatta Bana. In his poem, he has described the life and victory of Vemu Bhupala or Viparnarayana, the poet's patron. Himself born of Srivasa Gotra, Vamana claims a kinship with Bana and styles himself as one who can refute the popular belief that Bana could not be equaled in writing beautiful prose. His imitation of Bana is very close, and in spite of want of originality, Vamana's work contains many passages of considerable merit. Another work, prose work, is by by name Mathura Vijaya, written by Ganga Devi. She is the only recognized poetess in those days in Sanskrit literature. And even up today, we are able to see only Kampa Devi. This Ganga Devi was the queen of Kampana, the son of Bukka I, who ruled at Vijayanagar. This work of Ganga Devi, that is Mathura Vijaya, is incomplete. The royal poetess has described her husband's exploits, Kampana's expedition to the south and his conquest of Mathura. So, a queen writing about her husband and his exploits is something admirable and unique. And therefore, in Sanskrit literature, Ganga Devi stands as the unique poetess. Before we learn something about Champukavyas, let us have some idea about the authors Vanabhatta and others whom we have discussed. We have been telling that Vanabhatta is more or less a versatile genius, has covered all the subjects, and used all the literary phenomena in his work. He is undoubtedly a great poet of prose. In his Harshacharita, he has got a style of narrating beautifully the river Mandakini. As an instance of his poetic merit, I want to quote the style of Bana. While he is describing about the fall of Ganges from Akasha, which is called as Akasha Ganga, he says, Tvangat, Tungat, Tarangat, Tarat, Tarla, Taratara, Tarakam. How he is using the melodious rhythmic sentences. Not only that, he echoes through sounds the sense also, the meaning. Tata kramena dhruva pravrittam dharma dhenum iva adho dhavamana dhavala payodharam udhvara dhvanim antakamadana mouli malati malikam aliyamana malakilya ruddha rodasam arundhati dhauta taravatvacham tvanga tunga taranga tarat tarala taratara tarakam. Just like that he continues. What he wants to say, his idea or the intention or the dhvani, the suggestive idea in him, is to convey to the readers the purity, the sanctity of the Ganges and the association of Ganges with the divinities and sages. And also the sound that is echoing the fall of the Ganges. The meaning of the sentence which I have made is that this Akasha Ganga, starting from Dhruva Nakshatra, Tata Kramena Dhruva Pravrittam, slowly it starts from Dhruva. Dhruva Pravrittam, how it falls down? Dharma dhenumive adho dhavamana dhavala payodharam. Having the wide udder, as if the Kamadhenu is just diving from the Akasha to the earth. Dharma dhenumive adho dhavamana dhavala payodharam. How the river flow is there? Udhvaradvanim is making a sound, a noise. Rrr, 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 like that. that is called Udvardhuni, Udvardhuni. Now, how the water falls, where from it falls? Andhakamadanamoli malati malikam. Andhakamadanaha means that is the destroyer of Andhaka Asura, that is Shiva. Shiva is having some garland over his head. It is touching that garland and falling from his head also. Andhakamadanamoli malati malikam. ஆலீயமான வாலகில்லிய ருத்த ரோதசம். ஸோ இந்த ரிவர் த வாலகில்லிய ரிஷிஸ் டைவிங் டீப் அண்ட் பிளஞ்சிங் மேக்கிங் இட் எ பியூர் வாட்டர். அருந்ததி தௌத தாரவத்வஜம். அருந்ததி இஸ் நோட்டட் ஃபார் ஹர் சாஸ்டிட்டி. இட்ஸ் அ பொயட்டிக் கன்வென்ஷன் தட் வென்எவர் தே ரெஃபர் டு அருந்ததி தட் இட் இஸ் ஃபார் சிக்னிஃபையிங் தி சாஸ்டிட்டி. Arundhati is said to be always looking at the toe of Vasishtha, her husband, without allowing her eyes to roll about seeing others. So such a chaste lady comes and dives deep into the water and then washes her clothes. So it is so chaste. Tunga tunga taratarala taratara tarakam. He is echoing the sound. How? It is falling over the mountain, falling down, up, down, up, down, like that. And it is reflecting the stars in the sky. So, such a beautiful descriptions are found in Banabatta. Now, we will come to Champu Kavyas. Champu means Champayati, Champati, இது சம்பு. தஸ் டிஸ்கிரிப்ஷன்ஸ் ஆர் தி டெஃபினேஷன்ஸ் ஆர் ஃபவுண்ட். பட் யட் சம்பு காவியஸ் மீன்ஸ் தி மிக்சர் ஆஃப் ப்ரோஸ் அண்ட் போயட்ரி. கத்திய பத்திய மிஸ்ரிதம் காவியம் கத்தியமித்யபிதீயதே. மாத்வீக மிருத்வீகையோஹோ இட் இஸ் அண்டர் டிஃபினேஷன். இட் இஸ் ஜஸ்ட் லைக் மிக்சிங் டூ ஸ்வீட் Drakshas and Madhu. Such a sweet thing. So it is a combination of prose and poetry. It is a narrative in mixed prose, as I told you. Powerful, picturesque descriptions are expressed in verse, while the narrative part is carried on generally in prose. We have got instances in Puranas where prose comes amidst verses. But there are more instances in classical period of this recognized class. It is only after the age of Mahakavyas and the prose romans that the champus could have begun to rise. But after 10th century AD, champus became very popular and they were largely composed in South India. Trivikrama Bhatta is an author of a champu kavya who belonged to 10th century AD. He mentions Bana in the introductory verses to his work Damayanti Katha or Nala Champu. So he is the first person recognized as the author of Champu who wrote Nala Champu. Boja of 11th century AD, the author of Saraswati Kantavarna, mentions this poet. This is an incomplete work with 7 chapters. According to this poet, ordinary expressions are not appreciable for poetry, and so long and cumbersome compounds, fears of double meanings, are abundantly used in this work. Now we come across another champu called Yashastilaka Champu by Somadeva. Harikesari of 10th century AD, belonging to Chalukya race, patronized the poet Somadeva, who wrote this Yashastilaka Champu. In 7 aswasas, that means aswasa means here chapters, the book relates the story of King Yashodhara, lord of Avanti, his conversion to Jaina faith, his assassination and rebirth. The last 3 chapters are the explanatory or the sacred text of Jainism. There are plenty of moral and ethical sentiments in this work, which makes it more a didactic composition than a literary performance. Boja's Ramayana Champu. Bhoja was a celebrated king of Dara, ruled between 1018 and 1063 AD. Ramayana Champu or Bhoja Champu or Champu Ramayana is ascribed to Bhoja. An uncertain tradition says that Bhoja composed the prose portions and Kalidasa the verses, who the latter was temporarily recalled to life by the magical power of King Bhoja. Bhoja composed only up to the end of Sudrakanda, while Lakshmana Kavi of some later date wrote the Yuddhakanda. All kinds of meters are employed, and the prose portion is full of long compounds after the manner of Gadya Kavyas. The poetic sentiments and descriptions are fine, though familiar. This Champu is very popular among the lovers of Ramayana. Then we come across Bharata Champu, written by Ananta Bhatta. This work has a fairly wide vocabulary and a great variety of figures of speech and meters. This has beautifully summarized the Mahabharata. He seems to have written Bhagavata Champu also to complete Abhinava Kalidasa. Narayana Bhattatri, the author of Narayaniyam, quotes frequently from this Champu. He belonged to the 15th century AD. Abhinava Kalidasa's Bhagavata Champu. We have already said that there is a Champu called Bhagavata Champu, written by Abhinava Kalidasa, who belonged to Vellala family from Andhra Pradesh. As the name signifies, it is dealing with Bhagavata. He has also written another Champu by name Abhinava Bharata Champu. He lived during 11th century AD. Now we come across Chidambara Kavi, regarding whom we have already seen when we talked about Shravya Kavya, where he has written the Trisandhana Kavya, Raghava, Yadava, Pandaviya. The same Chidambara Kavi of 17th century AD, patronized by King Venkata I of Vijayanagar, has composed Bhagavata Champu, describing the story of Krishna. Panchakalyana Champu, written by him, describes simultaneously the stories of the marriages of Rama, Krishna, Vishnu, Shiva, and Skanda. It's really wonderful. In one verse, he is able to give 5 stories. He has written a Mahakavya by name Raghava Pandava Yadaviya. Next, we come across Kumarasambha Champu, written by Raja Sarfoji I. Raja Sarfoji I, who ruled Tanjore between 1715 and 1727 AD, a great patron of poets and an artist, wrote his Kumarasambha Champu. It bears close similarity in language and subject matter to the poem on the topic by Kalidasa. Nilakanta Dikshitas, Nilakanta Vijaya Champu. Nilakanta Dikshitas Champu describes in 5 chapters the story of churning of milky ocean by devas and asuras, and the part played by Shiva to save the world by taking the halahala poison which arose out of the ocean. This episode accounts for Lord Shiva's name as Nilakanta. His style in Shiva Leela Arnava is very simple and graceful, while that in the Champu is full of long compounds. Of course, it is required while you are narrating in prose. Then we come across a peculiar Champu, Vishwagunadhar's Champu. It's the device of presenting this Champu itself is so novel. It is written by Venkatadri, who lived in the later part of the 18th century. He was the son of Raghunatha and Sitamba. His Champu, Vishwagunadhar's Champu, is popular. In this, 2 Gandharvas, that is Vishwavasu and Krishanu by name, fly over the earth in their aerial car. So this concept itself is something new. 2 persons traveling on the aerial car debating the merits and defects of several important places of pilgrimage, professions, institutions, etc. One of these two Gandharvas, Krishanu, always condemns them on several grounds, and the other, Vishwavasu, after refuting him, points out the merit and the greatness. So that Krishanu is always looking at the negative side of anything he looks at, and Vishwavasu is a positive approacher. He looks the brightness of things in everything. So it is a novel idea by the poet to reveal the good and bad, the merits and demerits of the subject that he has chosen, by expressing through two different characters. Thus, in the form of a dialogue, the poet's opinions about the brighter and darker sides of things are also brought out very powerfully. This work was intended to expose the fault in the customs and manner of his time. Then Jeevandara Champu, written by Harichandra. He is a Jaina person, and he tells the life story of Jivaka or Jeevandara. Of course, this work is of artificial type. Now, in this module, what we have seen? We have seen two segments. One is prose and the other one is Champu. Prose, of course, we know that with long compounds, Banavatta, Dandin, and other writers have attempted and succeeded. Though most of the writers were afraid of touching upon prose writing. And with regard to Champus, of course, it is just like Kathagala Chepa nowadays, that there is a song and then narration, song, narration. Here also in Champu Kavyas, we find verses and then narration in prose. And the entire sentence is composed in rhythmic style, which is more attractive. So we can say that the modern day's Kathakalakshepa emanated from the type of Champu Kavyas of Sanskrit. With this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.